Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I should like now to introduce the featured artist of this evening's ordeal. I'm sure that you will all agree without any hesitation that Tom Lehrer is the most brilliant creative genius that America has produced in almost 200 years. And so perhaps a few words of biographical background might not be amiss. Endowed by nature with perhaps the most glorious baritone voice to be heard on any stage since the memorable concert debut in 1906 of Neville Chamberlain, endowed also with 12 incredibly agile fingers, Mr. Lehrer has had a long and varied career in the field of entertainment, starting with 9 years at Harvard University, where it was that he first decided to devote his life to what has since become a rather successful scientific project, namely the attempt to prolong adolescence beyond all previous limits. Even before he came to Harvard, however, he was well known in academic circles for his masterly translation into Latin of The Wizard of Oz, which remains, even today, the standard Latin version of that work. A few years ago, he was inducted forcibly into the United States Army and spent most of his indenture in Washington as a sort of army liaison to the Office of Naval Contemplation. About his service record, he is justifiably modest, but it is known that in a short time he rose to the rank of Brigadier General. However, before he could acquire tenure, he was discharged, and owing to nepotism and intrigue, he emerged with only the rank of Specialist Third Class, which was roughly equivalent in the American Army to your rank of Corporal without portfolio. But to return to his career in show business, for several years he toured vaudeville theaters with an act consisting of impressions of people in the last throes of various diseases. Some of you here tonight perhaps may recall with pleasure his memorable diphtheria imitation. He is generally acknowledged to be one of the greatest living American composers and is currently working on a musical comedy based on the life of Adolf Hitler. So without further ado, Tom Lehrer. You'd be amazed at the money we save that way. Well, what I like to do on formal occasions like this is to take some of the various types of songs that we all know and presumably love, and, as it were, to kick them when they're down. I find that if you take the various popular song forms to their logical extremes, you can arrive at almost anything from the ridiculous to the obscene, or, as they call that in America, sophisticated. And I'd like to... I'd like to illustrate with several hundred examples for you this evening. First of all, I thought I'd start off with a really typical American type of song to get you attuned to my foreign accent. One of the favorite topics for American songwriters is our South, or as we call it, Dixie. And it's always seemed to me, though, that most of these songs really don't go far enough. The following song, on the other hand, goes too far. It's called I Want to Go Back to Dixie. Go back to Dixie, take me back to dear old Dixie. That's the only little old place for little old me. Old times they are not forgotten, whopping slaves and selling cotton and waiting for the Robert E. Lee. It was never there on time. I'll go back to the Swanee, where pellagra makes you scrawny and the honeysuckle clutters up the vine. I really am a fixin' to go home and start a mixin' down below that Mason-Dixon line. Oh, won't you come with me to Alabama, back to the arms of my dear old mammy? Her cookin's lousy and her hands are clammy, but what the hell, it's home. Yes, for paradise, the Southland is my nominee. Just give me a ham hock and a grit of harmony. I want to go back to Dixie. I want to be a Dixie Pixie and eat corn pone till it's coming out of my ears. I want to talk with Southern gentlemen and put that white sheet on again. I ain't seen one good lynching in years. The land of the boll weevil, where the laws are medieval, is calling me to come and nevermore roam. I want to go back to the Southland, that you all and shut my mouth land. Be it ever so decadent, there's no place like home. I should like to insert a small footnote at this point to the effect that I shall be singing these songs in the original American, but I will attempt to explain them briefly in English as I go along. However, some of them may get a bit too American in spots, so that some of you may be on rather a sticky wicket when it comes to these. We had hoped to provide a glossary of terms, but this was found to be economically unfeasible, so if you do find you have some difficulty in understanding, I suggest perhaps the best thing to do would be to drop a note to the American Embassy in Canberra, and I'm sure they'll be delighted to assist you. Failing that, though, if there is any difficulty in comprehension, I would suggest that you approach this evening's performance in the same spirit as you would, say, a performance of a Wagner opera in German, namely that the sheer overwhelming beauty of the music precludes the necessity for understanding exactly what's going on. If I may indulge in a bit of personal history at this point, a few years ago I worked for a while for the Atomic Energy Commission, known affectionately as the AEC, at the Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory in New Mexico. I had a job there as a spy. No, I expect you know that the staff out there at that time was composed almost exclusively of spies. of one persuasion or another. And as some of you may know, New Mexico is in the heart of the gun smoke and wagon train district, although in recent years, the area has been used for testing of somewhat more refined weapons than those used in the old westerns, and nowadays a security clearance is a more valuable thing to have than a shooting iron. So to commemorate that delightful metamorphosis, here is a modern cowboy ballad called The Wild West Is Where I Wanna Be. Trail, you'll find me lopin' Why, the spaces are wide open in the land of the old AEC. Why, the scenery's attractive and the air is radioactive. Oh, the Wild West is where I wanna be. Mid the sagebrush and the cactus, I'll watch the fellas practice dropping bombs through the clean desert breeze. I'll have on my sombrero, and of course I'll wear a pair of Levi's over my lead BVDs. We'll leave the city's rush, leave the fancy and the plush, leave the snow and leave the slush and the crowds. I will seek the desert's hush, where the scenery is lush. How I long to see the mush room clouds. Mid the yuccas and the thistles, I'll watch the guided missiles while the old FBI watches me. Yes, I'll soon make my appearance, soon as I can get my clearance, 'cause the Wild West is where I wanna be. Now we come to a peculiar type of American song known as the football fight song. I'm not going to attempt to explain to you the American game of football. That particular bit of Americana has never been satisfactorily explained to me. But I will go so far as to say that although you do have a game here which is roughly comparable to our football, at least in the sense that it is equally pointless, you do not, I believe, have any counterpart to our football fight song, and it is with that aspect of the problem that I propose to deal. Many years ago, during my undergraduacy, there used to be these long, long Saturday afternoons in the autumn with nothing to do. The library was closed. Just waiting around for the cocktail parties to begin. And some of us used to wander over to the, I believe it was called the stadium, to see what might be going on there. And on occasions like this, one did come to realize that the football fight songs, which one hears in comparable American stadia, have a tendency to be somewhat uncouth and even violent, and that it would be refreshing, to say the least, to find one that was a bit more genteel. And here it is, dedicated to my own alma mater and called Fight Fiercely, Harvard. Harvard, fight, 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 demonstrate to them our skill. Albeit they possess the might, nonetheless we have the will. How we will celebrate our victory, we shall invite the whole team up for tea. How jolly! Hurl that spheroid down the field and fight, fight, fight. Fiercely, Harvard, fight, 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 impress them with our prowess, do. Oh, fellows, do not let the crimson down, be of stout heart and true. Come on, chaps, fight for Harvard's glorious name. Won't it be peachy if we win the game? Oh, goody, let's try not to injure them, but fight, fight, fight. Let's not be rough, though. Fight, 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 and do fight fiercely. Fight, fight, fight. I mentioned before that there is no direct Australian counterpart to that type of song, and in pointing out these differences between the American and Australian cultures, I should add that I have been surprised at how similar the American and Australian ways of life are. I hope you won't take offense at that. Some countries do, you know. But naturally, there are many basic differences. For example, in Boston, Massachusetts, on the outskirts of which I live and which is one of the oldest cities in the United States, it is considered a matter of great pride for one to be able to claim that he is descended from the original settlers. Such, I gather, is not the case here. While I'm on this general subject, I should be frank and say that there are many respects in which you are definitely years behind us. For example, your divorce rate, your juvenile delinquency rate, your mental illness rate are all shockingly low compared to ours. And I do feel that you will have to put your shoulders to the wheel if you intend to catch up to our degree of civilization. Although you do go in for hunting in Australia, you do not, I believe, practice the peculiar form of deer hunting in which we engage in the States, which goes roughly as follows. These deer hunters put on bright red hats and go out and attempt to shoot deer. If they succeed in this, they tie them to the sides and the front and the tops of their cars and drive them home. What they do with them when they get them home, I have not been able to ascertain. I suspect that some sort of primitive sacrament is involved. But anyway, that's the way it's supposed to work in theory, but actually, during the hunting season, which takes place in the autumn, you see almost every day at least one item in the newspapers about somebody who has shot someone else under the impression, presumably, that he was a deer with a bright red hat. Or possibly a large flesh-colored squirrel. It seems to me that this marks an encouraging new trend in a grand old sport and deserves a new type of hunting song, which I present herewith. I always will remember 'twas a year ago November I went out to hunt some deer on a morning bright and clear. I went and shot the maximum the game laws would allow, 2 game wardens, 7 hunters, and a cow. I was in no mood to trifle, I took down my trusty rifle and went out to stalk my prey. What a haul I made that day. I tied them to my fender and I drove them home somehow, 2 game wardens, 7 hunters, and a cow. The law was very firm, it took away my permit, the worst punishment I ever endured. It turned out there was a reason, cows were out of season, and one of the hunters wasn't insured. People ask me how I do it, and I say there's nothing to it. You just stand there looking cute, and when something moves, you shoot. And there's 10 stuffed heads in my trophy room right now, 2 game wardens, 7 hunters, and a purebred Guernsey cow. For many years now, Mr. Danny Kaye, who has been my particular idol since childbirth, has been doing a routine about the great Russian director Stanislavski and the secret of success in the acting profession. And I thought it might possibly be of interest to adapt this idea to the field of mathematics, I always like to make explicit the fact that before my career was cut short in its prime, I was, in fact, an incipient mathematician. I don't like people to get the idea that I have to do this for a living. I mean, it isn't as though I had to do this, you know. I could be making, oh, £800 a year just teaching. Be that as it may, some of you may have had occasion to run into mathematicians and to wonder, therefore, how they got that way. And here, in partial explanation, perhaps, is the story of the great Russian mathematician Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky. Who made me the genius I am today, the mathematician that others all quote? Who's the professor that made me that way? The greatest that ever got chalk on his coat. One man deserves the credit, one man deserves the blame, and Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky is his name. Hi, Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky. I am never forget the day I first meet the great Lobachevsky. In one word, he told me secret of success in mathematics. Plagiarize. Plagiarize. Let no one else's work evade your eyes. Remember why the good Lord made your eyes, so don't shade your eyes. But plagiarize, plagiarize, plagiarize. Only be sure always to call it, please, research. And ever since I meet this man, my life is not the same. And Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky is his name. Hey, Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky. I'll never forget the day I am given first original paper to write. It was on analytic and algebraic topology of local Euclidean metrization of infinitely differentiable Riemannian manifold. Boże moi. This I know from nothing. But I think of great Lobachevsky and I get idea. Ha ha! I have a friend in Minsk who has a friend in Pinsk, whose friend in Omsk has friend in Tomsk with friend in Akhmolinsk. His friend in Alexandrovsk has friend in Petropavlovsk, whose friend somehow is solving now the problem in Dniepropetrovsk. And when his work is done, aha, begins the fun. From Dniepropetrovsk to Petropavlovsk, by way of Ilyisk and Novorossiysk, to Alexandrovsk to Akhmolinsk, to Tomsk to Omsk to Pinsk to Minsk, to me the news will run. Yes, to me the news will run. And then I write by morning, night, and afternoon, and pretty soon my name in Dniepropetrovsk is cursed. When he finds out, I publish first. And who made me a big success and brought me wealth and fame? Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky is his name. Hi, Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky. I'll never forget the day my first book is published. Every chapter I stole from somewhere else. Index I copy from old Vladivostok telephone directory. This book was sensational. Pravda? Ah, pravda. Pravda said Jill Bill Karoli Kagdat Prinyom Blacha Jila, it stinks. But Izvestia. Izvestia said Ya idu kudasam tsar idiot peshkom, it stinks. Metro Goldwyn Moskva bought the movie rights for 6 million rubles, changing title to The Eternal Triangle, with Marilyn Monroe playing part of hypotenuse. And who deserves the credit? And who deserves the blame? Nikolai Ivanovich Lobachevsky is his name. And now I'd like to turn to the folk song, which has become in recent years the particularly fashionable form of idiocy among the self-styled intellectuals in the States. People who deplore the level of current popular songs, although I will admit that they seem to be recording almost anything these days. Have you heard Sessue Hayakawa's record of Remember Pearl Harbor? Anyway. people who deplore the level of current popular songs and yet will sit around enthralled singing Jimmy Crack Corn and I Don't Care, or Green Grow the Rushes, oh, whatever that means. At any rate, for these elite, if we have any with us this evening, I should like to do an ancient Irish ballad, which was written a few years ago, and which is replete with all the accoutrements of this art form. In particular, it has a sort of idiotic refrain, in this case, rickety-tickety-tin, coming along from time to time, running through, I might add, interminable verses. The large number of verses being a feature expressly designed to please the true devotees of the folk song, who seem to find singing 50 verses of On Top of Old Smoky is twice as enjoyable as singing 25. This type of song has also what is known technically in music as a modal tune. This means, for the benefit of any layman who may have wandered in this evening, that I play a wrong note every now and then. I think you'll notice that. I should say, this song does differ strikingly from the genuine folk ballad in that in this song, the words which are supposed to rhyme actually do. Oh. In all fairness, I'm not directing these remarks against the vast army of folk song lovers, but merely against that peculiar hardcore who seem to equate authenticity with merit and illiteracy with charm. Oh, one more thing. One of the more important aspects of public folk singing is audience participation, and this happens to be a splendid song for group singing. So if any of you feel like joining in with me on this next song, I would appreciate it if you would leave right now. About a maid I'll sing a song, sing rickety-tickety-tin. About a maid I'll sing a song who didn't have her family long. Not only did she do them wrong, she did every one of them in, she did every one of them in. One morning in a fit of pique, sing rickety-tickety-tin. One morning in a fit of pique, she drowned her father in the creek. The water tasted bad for a week, and we had to make do with gin, we had to make do with gin. Her mother, she could never stand, sing rickety-tickety-tin. Her mother, she could never stand, and so a cyanide soup she planned. The mother died with a spoon in her hand, and her face in a hideous grin, a grin, her face in a hideous grin. She set her sister's hair on fire, a rickety-tickety-tin. She set her sister's hair on fire, and as the smoke and flame rose higher, danced around the funeral pyre, a playin' a violin, olin, playin' a violin. She weighted her brother down with stones, a rickety-tickety-tin. She weighted her brother down with stones and sent him off to Davy Jones. All they ever found were some bones and occasional pieces of skin, of skin. Occasional pieces of skin. One day when she had nothing to do, sing rickety-tickety-tin. One day when she had nothing to do, she cut her baby brother in two and served him up as an Irish stew and invited the neighbors in, boys in, invited the neighbors in. And when at last the police came by, sing rickety-tickety-tin. And when at last the police came by, her little pranks she did not deny. To do so she would have had to lie, and lying she knew was a sin, a sin. Lying she knew was a sin.
My tragic tale I won't prolong, rickety-tickety-tin. My tragic tale I won't prolong, and if you do not enjoy my song, you've yourselves to blame if it's too long. You should never have let me begin, begin. You should never have let me begin.
The most popular type of popular song in any country is, of course, the love song, and I'd like to illustrate several subspecies of this form during the evening. First of all, the type of love song in which the fellow informs the girl that although the years ahead will almost certainly destroy every vestige of her already dubious charms, that nonetheless his love for her will shine on forever through the years, you know? Another example of stark realism in the popular song. This particular example is called When You Are Old and Gray, and I'd like to dedicate it to anyone in the audience who is still in love with each other.
Since I still appreciate you, let's find love while we may. Because I know I'll hate you when you are old and gray. So say you love me here and now, I'll make the most of that. Say you love and trust me, for I know you'll disgust me when you're old and getting fat. An awful debility, a lessened utility, a loss of mobility is a strong possibility. In all probability, I'll lose my virility and you your fertility and desirability. And this liability of total sterility will lead to hostility and a sense of futility. So let's act with agility while we still have facility, for we'll soon reach senility and lose the ability. Teeth will start to go, dear. Your waist will start to spread. In 20 years or so, dear, I'll wish that you were dead. I'll never love you then at all the way I do today. So please remember, when I leave in December, I told you so in May.
This might be as good a moment as any to insert a small commercial for some recordings I have made of some of these songs, which are carried by most of the less scrupulous record shops throughout Australia. If your own favorite record dealer does not have them, I suggest you simply belt him one right in the teeth. These recordings were designed actually for those discriminating few in each community to whom quality is no object. There is one difficulty with them, I should be frank with you. They are unfortunately unbreakable. However, we have a vast research staff at work on this very problem, even now as I address you here, and we hope to make them in time, if not breakable, at least soluble in water. So much for the commercial. Now we come to the Dear Hearts and Gentle People school of songwriting, in which the author tells you that no matter how much sin and vice and crime and corruption go on where he comes from, it's still the best place in the world because it's home, you know, sort of gets you. This example is called My Hometown. ¶¶
a yen to go back once again, back to the place where no one wears a frown, to see once more those super special, just plain folks in my hometown. No fellow could ignore the little girl next door. She sure looked sweet in her first evening gown. Now there's a charge for what she used to give for free in my hometown. I remember Dan, the druggist on the corner. He was never mean or ornery, he was swell. He killed his mother-in-law and ground her up real well, and sprinkled just a bit over each banana split. The guy that taught us maths, who never did take baths, acquired a certain measure of renown. And after school he sold the most amazing pictures in my hometown. That fellow was no fool who taught our Sunday school, and neither was our kindly Parson Brown. I think I'll leave this line out. There may be someone here tonight from Adelaide in my hometown. I remember Sam, good old Sam. He was the village idiot, and though it seems a pity, it was so. He loved to burn down houses just to watch the glow, and nothing could be done because he was the mayor's son. The guy that took a knife and monogrammed his wife, then dropped her in the pond and watched her drown. Oh yes, indeed, the people there are just plain folks in my hometown. You're probably familiar with songs about the old lamplighter and the old dream peddler and the old garbage collector and all these lovable old characters that go around spreading sweetness and light to their respective communities. But it's always seemed to me that there is one member of this happy band who does an equally fine job, but who has never been properly celebrated in song or story. And this is an attempt to remedy, at least in part, that deplorable situation. When the shades of night are falling, comes a fellow everyone knows. It's the old dope peddler, spreading joy wherever he goes. Every evening you will find him around our neighborhood. It's the old dope peddler, doing well by doing good. He gives the kids free samples because he knows full well that today's young innocent faces will be tomorrow's clientele. Here's a cure for all your troubles, here's an end to all distress. It's the old dope peddler with his powdered happiness. I realize it's very bad form to quote from one's own reviews, but I would like to mention something that the New York Times said about me once, which I have always treasured. They said, "Mr. Lehrer's muse is not fettered by such inhibiting factors as taste." Mm-hmm.
But enough of former triumphs. I'd like to turn again to the love song and illustrate the... I generally like to include at least one or two love songs in the evening's program, partly perhaps to convince people that even at the Harvard University Graduate School, that hotbed of celibacy that I used to call home, we did have our moments. Anyway, I'd like to consider the Viennese waltz variety of love song of the Franz Lehar Johann Strauss school, conjuring up images of gaily waltzing couples and probably stale champagne drunk from sweaty slippers. This illustration is called the Wiener Schnitzel Waltz.
Do you remember the night I held you so tight as we danced to the Wiener Schnitzel Waltz? The music was gay and the setting was Viennese. Your hair wore some roses, or perhaps they were peonies. I was blind to your obvious faults. As we danced across the scene to the strains of the Wiener Schnitzel Waltz. Oh, I drank some champagne from your shoe, la la la. I was drunk by the time I got through, la la la. For I didn't know, as I raised that cup, it had taken two bottles to fill the thing up. It was I who stepped on your dress, la la la. The skirts all came off, I confess, la la la. Revealing for all of the others to see just what it was that endeared you to me. Your lips were like wine, but your teeth rather yellowish. The music was lovely, quite Ivor Novello-ish. I drank wine, you drank chocolate malts. And we both turned quite green to the strains of the Wiener Schnitzel Waltz.
One more love song. This one is a tender little ballad entitled simply, I Hold Your Hand in Mine.
I hold your hand in mine, dear. I press it to my lips. I take a healthy bite from your dainty fingertips. My joy would be complete, dear, if you were only here. But still I keep your hand as a precious souvenir. The night you died, I cut it off. I really don't know why. For now, each time I kiss it, I get blood stains on my tie. I'm sorry now I killed you, for our love was something fine. Until they come to get me, I shall hold your hand in mine.
Oh, very good. I've been delighted to find that people in Australia are just as sick as those back home. Good on you. This is actually is particularly rewarding to me because I have always regarded it as part of my mission in life to follow around after Billy Graham and try and undo some of the work he has done. I see. You can make your decisions backstage after the show. Well, anyway, I have time for one more here, and this is a little song dedicated to the Boy Scouts. We seem to have several patrols here tonight. The Boy Scouts, those noble little bastions of democracy. And the RSL of tomorrow. Their motto is, as you know, be prepared, and that is the name of the song. Be prepared. That's the Boy Scouts' marching song. Be prepared. As through life you march along, be prepared to hold your liquor pretty well. Don't write naughty words on walls if you can't spell. Be prepared. To hide that pack of cigarettes, don't make a book. If you cannot cover bets, keep those reefers hidden where you're sure that they will not be found. And be careful not to smoke them when the scoutmaster's around, for he only will insist that they be shared. Be prepared. Be prepared. That's the Boy Scouts' solemn creed. Be prepared. And be clean in word and deed. Don't solicit for your sister, that's not nice. Unless you get a good percentage of her price. Be prepared. And be careful not to do your good deeds when there's no one watching you. If you're looking for adventure of a new and different kind, and you come across a Girl Scout who is similarly inclined, don't be nervous, don't be flustered, don't be scared. Be prepared.